The Viking was a long time ago.
We're talking to a Viking.
Oh. Individual time trial.
What's that?
Time trial. If it was flat, I could go pretty good, but on the hills, I lost a lot of momentum. But the first thing people want to know, well, first of all, thank you all for coming out. At least it's a little warmer than last night. And I want to thank everybody here who finally figured out how to make my PowerPoint CD work, and for all their technical expertise, which I lack. But getting back to the book, the first thing that people want to know, that the question that surprised me was pretty much, why did you write the book? It wasn't about Edmund Muskie or anything like that, just why did you write the book? Because like Edmund Muskie, I was born in Rumford, although I never met him, and the 100th anniversary of his birth was coming up, and so I decided somebody needed to commemorate it, and the easiest thing to do, being from Rumford and now living in Lewiston, so I know a lot of the, familiar with a lot of the area that Ed trod when he was in Maine. I figured the Maine years would be doable because, I was just telling Chris Beam that once he gets to Washington, things get complicated in a big hurry. So the dates up here are, the dates that he lived, a lot of people say, gee, I thought he lived longer than that. Well, he did. He passed away in 1996, I think 2 days before his 82nd birthday. And it's, actually he left the state in early 1959, so that's the first mistake up there, and my middle initial is L, not A, so, but outside of that, it's fine. So what I'll do is I'll go through, these are all the pictures from the book, they go in chronological order, because of course that's the only way it makes any sense. And I will kind of narrate his life off the pictures, starting with that's the book cover. Right. This is Rumford, Congress Street in Rumford around 1890. And I believe this is, Congress Street is as long as I can remember, it's been one way. And I think this is going facing down Congress Street toward the falls, although it's really hard to tell. But they were doing some major construction. And this is about 20 years before Stephen and Josephine Muskie arrived in Rumford for what Stephen had told his bride, that this was going to be their honeymoon, and then they were going to return to Buffalo, where her family was. And then when they got to Rumford, he said, well, actually we're staying here. I've got an apartment, and I've also taken in two boarders, so she had to learn to cook. You know, not just for the two of them, but for the two boarders they had taken in. Stephen Muskie was a tailor, and by all accounts, pretty much the best one in Rumford, and there were actually a few at the time. And this is, as you can see, Stephen Muskie, custom tailor, and the man in the photograph is not Stephen Muskie. That is, that gentleman is probably, most likely, Nicola Bevilacqua, who had the shoe shine and repair shop located down the steps below Muskie's tailor shop. And it was there in 1933 where a fire started that burned down that building and two or three more, damaged several businesses on Congress Street. Very early, I think it was around Valentine's Day, 1933, when Ed Muskie was a freshman at Bates College. His family decided not to tell him about the fire until he came home for vacation because they didn't want it to interfere with his studies. And all Stephen Muskie did was take his insurance money and move across Congress Street onto Exchange Street, where he reopened his tailor business and ran it until he retired in 1947, when he sold it to Vito Umbro. Yes. You're from Dublin.
Yeah.
So, oh, I thought you were. Sorry. Let's see.
I grew up. I spent a long time there.
This, in the book, I have this as the Muskie family, which it sort of is, but it turns out that the gentleman in the lower right is not Ed's younger brother Gene, as I originally thought. There's nothing on the back of the photograph at base. That turns out to be the husband of Ed's sister Lucy, who's next to him in the black jacket. And the little girl is not the his youngest sister, but it's probably the daughter of his sister, who is standing behind her. This is at their house on Hemingway Street in Rumford, for which Stephen Muskie pretty much paid cash for everything he ever owned. He saved up and paid cash for it. The Muskies, half of the Muskie children, of Stephen and Josephine's children, were born Muskie, or christened Muskie when they were born. And the other half were Marshashevsky, is Stephen's original name. And there's no rhyme or reason. It's not like the first three were Marshashevsky and the last three were Muskie. They're all kind of intermixed as far as the last name they got. And a lot of, one of the big misconceptions is that Stephen Marshashevsky, everybody always says, oh, his name has changed at Ellis Island because the immigration official couldn't pronounce Marshashevsky, so from now on, your name is Muskie. And that appears not to be anywhere near the truth. In fact, I discovered that Ed Muskie didn't learn until he graduated from Cornell Law School in 1939 that three of his siblings were Marshashevsky. Ed Muskie was always Ed Muskie. But in 1939, he had to go and legally change the names of everyone who was still a Marshashevsky, because his father said, I never changed it legally in case you didn't like Muskie and wanted to change it back. And Ed said, I'm fine, I've always been a Muskie and I'll always be a Muskie. So he went ahead and fixed that. This is the high school picture, his high school yearbook picture from Stevens High School, from where he graduated in 1932. Now there's a park there with some stonework that went over the front doorway. I think that's all that's left of the Stevens building now. And it was at Stevens where he learned, he got two important, the two aspects of his life that would become most important to him or were opened up to him by a couple of teachers there at Stevens. Miss Celia Clary was the debating coach, and of course Ed would become famous for his debating at Rumford and later at Bates. And he said that she should be a track coach because she literally she would chase him around the halls trying to get him to go out for the debating team, to the point where he would stick his head out the door to see if the hallways were clear before he went to his next class. But she finally caught him. And he took to debating very well, of course, and that helped him a lot in his 1954 campaign, where he, when TV was just coming into its own in Maine, Maine's elections back then were in September, as Maine goes, so goes the nation, and so he used his debating skills to quickly weigh both sides of an issue and give a quick, concise answer in 30 or 60 seconds, whatever he was allowed. So I contend that Ed Muskie may very well be the very first politician ever to use a soundbite in the history of the United States. And another interesting thing to me, as far as this picture, is his hair. I'll slick back like that because most people remember Ed Muskie more like that, with his hair being everywhere combed by his secretaries before any TV interviews. Another, I think, general misconception is that Ed Muskie He was very intelligent, of course, and earned a scholarship to Bates, and then, just before he graduated from Bates, another one to Cornell. And everybody thinks, well, he just got a free ride through college and law school. And again, nothing could be further from the truth. The scholarship he got to Bates was just probably enough to pay for a quarter or a third of each of his first two semesters at the college. And he had to work first as a dishwasher, and then I think for 2 years, and then for many years, even after he graduated from law school in 1939, he worked as a bellhop at the Narragansett by the Sea in Kennebunk Beach. And he's shown standing here with Lucy in 1935. And Lucy is the next sibling, the next child after him, and she's the one to whom he was always the closest. There are a lot of letters in the Muskie archives between the two of them, especially when he was working summers at Kennebunk Beach. This is younger brother Gene with Ed. Ed joined the Navy in 1942. After graduating from law school in 39, he went back home to Rumford briefly, where he was a substitute teacher at Stevens High School and at Mexico High School while he studied for the bar exam. And in 1940, he purchased a law practice in Waterville from the widow of Carl Blackington, who had died suddenly, for I believe it was $3,000. And then shortly, of course, around that time, there were the first rumblings of war, and at which point a friend wrote to him and said, told him he should join the Navy because the food is pretty good and you don't have to sleep in mud holes, basically. So he joined the Navy 2 years later and went, since he showed no mechanical aptitude whatsoever, the Navy put him in its diesel mechanics school for propulsion for battleships, destroyers. He was eventually stationed on a destroyer escort, but took so much specialized training, submarine chasing, and ship and aircraft identification, went from Florida to Michigan to New York. He was stationed around New York City for a few months on a gasoline-powered ship, since he was a diesel expert. But by the time he got into the actual combat zone, the war was pretty much winding down. He was fortunate that he didn't see much action. He said his ship, but his ship was more badly damaged in a typhoon than by any enemy fire. So he escaped the war fairly unscathed. This picture is probably when he was stationed in New York briefly before going to the Pacific. And Gene, Ed was, of course, everybody knows, quiet, studious, and very well-spoken, and considered everything carefully. And Gene couldn't be more different. Gene was big, strong, joking, laughing all the time. A lot of guys at the Oxford Paper Company remember when he was working on the rewinders that he was always joking around. One day, their father asked Gene, "Why can't you be more like Ed?" To which Gene replied something to the effect of, "Be like Ed. Be like Ed. I don't want to be like Ed. I want to drink beer." So that was Gene. And also seems to be one of the major hobbies in Rumford, too. After he got out of the Navy, he returned to his Waterville law practice, which had been sputtering along mostly with the help of his secretary, Marjorie, and her father, and another and a Rumford attorney who drove over there, I think, a couple times a week, just to keep it going, which pretty much paid his secretary's salary during the war. He returned, determined to build up his law practice, got to networking, joined the AmVets, networked with the local